Well, good morning, family. How are you going this morning on yet another beautiful Sunday morning? Can I encourage you this morning that as whether you're watching it with us right now live or whether you're watching it later on, can I encourage you when we come to this part of our service this morning that it's going to bring us into a time of hearing scriptures from the Lord and also hearing singing some praises of how great our God is. Let me read to you this morning from the Passion Version, Psalm 96, and it says this: Go ahead, sing your new song to the Lord. Let everyone in every language sing him a new song. Don't stop, keep on singing. Make his name famous. Tell everyone every day how wonderful he is. Give them the good news of our great Saviour. Take the message of his glory and miracles to every nation. Tell them about the amazing things he has done. For the Lord's greatness is beyond description, and he deserves all the praise that comes to him. He is our King, God, and is right to be in holy awe of him. Let's sing this morning as we come together and we sing Open Up the Heavens. Let's pray. Our good Father in heaven, we praise you, Lord, and recognize we offer up our song to you for all you are, our great God. Father, we come before you and ask that we would seek your face and see the things as you do. May you open up our hearts, Lord, and our ears and our minds that we would listen to what it is to what you have for us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's welcome Gary to the service this morning to speak to us.
Thank you, Tanya and Merrill. Worship is such an important part of our journey when we come together, because it's the worship that actually brings us to this point where we actually want to spend some time and reflect on the Word of God. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunities that we have to hear your Word. We pray, Lord, that as we come this morning, that you will open up our hearts, that we will hear that what you want to say to us as individuals and what you want to say to us as a community. And Father, we just pray for us as we meet together through this medium, and Lord, that you will bless us as we come together this morning. We ask this in your name. Amen. So I'll just take a moment here just to get myself a little bit organized. So this morning we're going to come and we're going to look at Matthew, just chapter 5, verse 8. And then we're going to reflect on the virtues of life. I'll just see what that slide comes up. Yep. So Steve, over the past few weeks, has been taking us on a journey of the values and the virtues in our lives. The early church catechism defined virtues as having a firm disposition to do the good. We're going to look at a verse, and the verse is Matthew chapter 5, verse 8, which is about, blessed are those who have a pure heart, for they will see God. And we're going to have a look at that this morning. And the catechism, the early church catechism, defined this disposition to do the good. And what kind of life we live and how it affects those around us. Aristotle, a Greek philosopher in the 4th century, could see these qualities in humans that help them flourish. Aristotle could see this uniqueness in human beings, and he called those qualities that make up people's lives human virtues. He identified things such as justice, such as fairness, such as courage, temperance, and friendship. And he believed if you had these characteristics in your life, you would have a happy and a good life. If only it was that easy, just to have these virtues in our lives, then we would be happy. But when you look around us, we see there's so many apps, so many books, so many things out there promoting how to have a happy life, how to have a good life. People are seeking to do that. So as you do, you get on Dr. Google. So I got on Dr. Google to look up, well, what does it mean? What can I have to have a happy life? This little thing I looked at gave you seven things to have a happy life. You might want to tick these down if you like. The first one is have 7 to 8 hours sleep. The second one is have, I know, we've got a bit of a smile here. Yeah, 7 to 8 hours sleep. Keep good company with good people. Do something meaningful each day. Think good thoughts of others. They're good points to a good life, aren't they? But will they make you happy? I wonder. There is so much more out there. Every day people are looking for the key for happiness and peace in their life. The truth is, the answer lies within you. It's not about all the actions that we do on the outside. It's about the inside. And Steve has walked us through this journey over the past few weeks on values and virtues, and he's walked us through a journey of character formation. Honor, loyalty, integrity, gratitude, contentment. Ingrained in our moral characters. When these are ingrained in our moral characters, then we reflect what Aristotle was saying. What he saw in humans, but he didn't identify with. We reflect the image of God to others. This character formation isn't just about a happy life. It is about a formation of a journey of being Christ-like, which brings contentment and peace in our lives. The modern church picked up on virtues of morality, and we picked up on things of promiscuity, materialism, and many other things that poorly affected the culture of our day. There's an article that I read in Christianity Today a long time ago, and it points out that the church boiled these virtues down to hard working. Some of us in the church boiled it down to hard working, honesty, abstinence, and we abandoned that there's so much more in our formation in the journey to Christ-like. I don't know about you, but when I sit and read the words of Jesus, I find the meaning of life right there. The Sermon on the Mount, which was probably given over several days, is Jesus' teaching on what is important in life. And he was teaching what is important in life against your social status, against your religious status, against your wealth. And what matters most in life is where the heart is, the very core of us, the very core of who you are. When we think of the heart, we think of emotions. We think of things like love. We think of things like sadness. We think of things like happiness. And we think of things like joy. Remember that great song that I'm sure you would have learnt in Sunday school? Is where is the joy? Deep down in my heart. But in Hebrew thinking, the heart also refers to the mind and to the thoughts. So when Jesus says, blessed are those who are pure of heart, he's saying, blessed are those whose thoughts and thinkings are focused on the things of God. And what is the promise? The promise is that we will see God. And you need to reflect a little bit on this on Matthew, because what Matthew, when he wrote to the Jews, he was writing them to tell them about the kingdom of God. And he was saying that you live in the kingdom of God now and the kingdom of God to come. Hebrews 12:14 reminds us that when we live a life that is focused on God with a pure heart, we live a life of peace. This is not a new thought. We can turn back to Psalm 24. Psalm 24 is an ascension psalm. It's a psalm where the Jews would sing going up the hill to worship God. And what does it say there? Who can go up the hill to worship God? Those with clean hands and a pure heart. It says there. It says that those who are not distracted by the falseness of the world around them. The pure heart lies very much in the words of Deuteronomy 6:5, where it says, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength." When this is where your heart is, our character formation that is soaked in the love of Jesus, that is going to be reflected to the world around us. You know that saying? When you talk about someone, you might say to them, they have a good heart. And the reason why we say that is because we see the actions around them. Kim and I have this great friend. He's a great man, and he just oozes Jesus. It doesn't matter who he's with. It doesn't matter where he is. You can be walking down the road. We'd be walking down the road, and he just stops and talks to people and makes sure he says hello to them. It doesn't matter what moment of time he's in. He can always see beyond himself. And he finds a way to engage with that person simply just to be present with them. He has this amazing ability to just reflect Jesus. There have been people that are living lives that are focused on Jesus. And I'm sure you know people just like that. One of my mentors who actually knew me since I was about 3 years old, one of my mentors in ministry, I would go and sit with him and just soak it up as he talked to me. And eternally, I just would say to myself, I just want to live a life just like that. I just want to identify as a person who is seeking this pure heart and a life of holiness. Because that is what character formation is. It's not a quick fix. It's not a two-tablet resolve. It's a long journey. It's a lifelong journey. It's about which directions are you setting your compass. And let's face it, in this journey, there are lots of crossroads that can take us down lots of different directions. But Jesus says, stay focused on the pure heart. The journey of holiness is well cemented in the fabric of the church. One of the things I loved was doing all those church histories, and we hear the stories of those desert fathers who would go out, live in desert caves, and they'd try to avoid the world around them because they want to stay pure, they wanted to stay sinless. There was other movements in the church around the 1800s where this life of holiness teaching came out, and it would lead to this ideas and thinking that we could have sinless perfection, which we know, or at least I know, I can't reach that this side of the grave. Paul in his writings makes it clear that this life journey in faith is a battle. And he takes on his own battle there in Romans 7:15 to 20, where he talks about the struggle to do right. In other passages, he talks about the thorn in his side. We live in the refiner's fire. If we seek the face of Jesus, we are called to live this life of holiness, seeking a pure heart. I have this book, it's called Called Streams of Living Waters by Foster. It was introduced to me many years ago, and it was introduced to me as a way to do some reading around spiritual formation. It's a book that celebrates all the traditions of the faith, the contemplative prayer life, the seeking of the Holy Spirit in the Pentecostal tradition, the social justice traditions of the Christian faith, living an incarnational life as a tradition of the faith, the evangelical, and then there's this chapter on the virtues of holiness. Every now and then I pick this book up out in my library and I go back in to read this chapter. And I would really love to unpack this chapter for you, but it would take too long. But there's four key points to this chapter. And the four key points are, and I'm just going to run through them very briefly, is discovering the strength of the holiness in our journey. The holiness tradition focuses on personal transformation. The holiness tradition emphasizes the pure heart. It assures a character formation and fosters a growth in grace. The ultimate goal of holiness tradition is this deeper formation of self. And I love the second line there. It's about picking up the habits of Jesus. Because the old is gone and the new path is there. And it's about a growth in grace. And the challenge is here, the growth in grace is that I actually have to do some work. I have to focus on training my life in the disciplines of the faith. I need to be engaging in the Word of God, reading regularly. I need to be meditating and praying and worshiping and celebrating. Being involved in the disciplines of faith that lead me to a point where I continually focus on a journey to live a life that is a living sacrifice to God, as it says in Romans 12:1. It would be really easy to say, well, I can't do that. I can't meet that bar. We can't do it on our own. We have the promise of the Holy Spirit with us. And throughout Scripture, we are encouraged that God walks this journey with us. When I think of God walking the journey with us, I think of God meeting Adam in the garden and just walking with him. God walks with us. Take a moment to think about life and how that journey is. I want to leave you with this little illustration this morning as we come to close. Take a moment and think about your computer and your devices that you have connected to the net. Turn it on and it's new and it runs perfectly. We're fortunate we've got people like James who can help us sort some of these things out, because every now and then we get this little virus and it gets, and initially you don't notice it and it starts to spread in your computer. And eventually it affects the whole workings of your computer. And the only way to fix it is to go deep into the very heart of the computer, into the operating system, and exterminate the virus. Then we set up another virus protector so it doesn't happen again. You get the correlation. Our hearts can be as vulnerable as our computers. We need a firewall protection. The focus on Jesus in our day-to-day lives just does that. But C.S. Lewis in Mere Christianity points to the end of this journey and says it is completed in death. The final part of character formation is when we see Jesus, when we meet him face to face. Matthew 5:8 says this, that blessed are those who are pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed here doesn't mean the joy and happiness as we think about it. It's a message of hope and joy that we find in following Jesus. This is about living out the kingdom now, here on earth. All the virtues that we've been challenged with over the past few weeks, they all sit in contrary to the world around us. But with a life that is focused on the kingdom of God, we live a life of hope. Here is the question, is there anything new under the sun? Well, no, not really. Life is life. So I want to take you back, a long way back, to a guy called Thomas A. Kempis, a monk. He was born in the 1380s. He wrote a book in the 1400s called The Imitation of Christ. You can still buy it today. And A. Kempis, in it, focuses on the words of Jesus, and he explores the virtues of humility, compassion, tolerance, and patience. So this morning I want to leave you with these words of Thomas A. Kempis as you head into this week. We must imitate Christ's life in his ways if we are to be truly enlightened and set free from the darkness of our own hearts. Let it be the most important thing we do, that is to reflect on the life of Jesus Christ. The formula is simple as it is as difficult. The pure heart. It is as simple as it is difficult to live a life that is ingrained with the virtues of Jesus. We need to have a heart that is focused on Jesus. Let us pray. Father, we pray as we go into this week, that we will go into this week with that thought, that we are focused on you. And as Thomas A. Kempis reminds us, as Scripture reminds us, as we've heard over the past few weeks, that we are in a life of a journey of character formation. And may that character formation lead us into a life of living, a life that imitates Jesus. We ask this in your name. Amen.
As we continue in that hope that Gary was talking to us about, What a great way to finish off our service this morning with a song that actually says, God so loved. Father God, we just thank you for the things that you do for us. And we thank you, Lord, that you gave us your Son and that that's how much you loved us. In Jesus' name. May I pray these words over you as we journey this week. May the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you and to give you peace. May his favour be upon you, may his presence go before you and beside you, in the morning and in the evening, and in your coming and in your going. Amen. See you next time.